more money, dammit!
So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Why not?
Trying to get on the Slice Radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's alright.
You might have it.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.
You know I blame it on industry. I blame it on.
Hello everyone and welcome to the Pace Radio Show. We are live, yes we are live here at lifestyleradio.net as well as .ca, 420radio.ca, and as always I'm in the front window here at Canada's in downtown Calmford. If you hear a little bit of noise in the background, it's because there's customers in the store. Tonight, I'm joined by my joint host, Kim Cooper. She is invited a guest who is an author, a photographer, and has written for many cannabis publications. But as always, before we're going to find out a little bit more about our guest, it's news time. And this week, we're going to talk with Kim. Hi, Kim.
Hey, Al. How's it going, man? Hi, everybody out there in Radio Land. Great to be back. How's Al tonight?
Al's not too bad, but he's got himself a little harvest wound, I'd say.
Yeah, I heard about it. You know what? I feel for you. I just can't reach.
I just can't believe that I would get injured trimming.
Yes.
Without even cutting myself. You know?
Yeah. No breaking of the skin was involved here or anything like that. You actually pulled a muscle from too many hours with scissors in your hands trimming your wonderful crop.
Correct. Yeah.
Which is why I feel for you. I just can't reach.
I was helping a fellow patient with their harvest, and that's what happens. They got injured, but
right,
it's that time of autumn flowers, right?
That's right. Harvests are coming in now. People are bringing them in. Some are waiting another week or two. Everybody in the north has pretty much got their stuff in. We've already had a couple of frosts up here, so, and it's only the beginning of October, so people are harvesting a little bit earlier this year, I think.
I agree. Yeah, and I know over the weekend there we had some frosts here.
We know our girls don't like that. You know, they can handle a couple, but not much more than that.
Yeah, and they don't like the heavy frost. A little light frost isn't bad.
Yeah.
Okay, in news items, we've got two main things. I see Alberta has put out their proposal for their marijuana or the cannabis legalization. I see it includes a minimum age of 18.
Yeah, it seems their plan pretty much mirrors Ontario's, except for the minimum age. That's the one big difference. They're going 18 instead of 19. I applaud them for that. But the rest of it, I mean, it's going under the Liquor Control Board, the same as Ontario.
They don't have a liquor. They don't have an LCBO in Alberta.
Well, they're going to create one.
What I'm reading is it says specialty stores. I guess that's pretty vague, isn't it?
Yeah. So they're saying that they're going to be some kind of a government run model. So they're going to create a CCBO, I guess, or a CCBA, I guess it would be. For the province there and strictly regulate and all of that. So we're not looking, I don't think, at mom and pop stores. Now, they say they're still getting input and final decisions haven't been made, but the lineup that they give is pretty specific.
Yeah.
And usually when they do that, they're not going to detour from that very much at all.
Why would they release this if they're still doing, talks with people?
That's right. They obviously have a plan.
Limit of 30 grams per purchase. No smoking and vaping in public unless it fall under the tobacco laws.
Yeah.
No vaping in vehicles, including the passengers.
Right.
So patient.
So patient. Now, see, now,
the one thing that I see here that is different than Ontario is I haven't heard anything about Ontario banning outdoor growing.
No. They're doing the same thing. They're just on board with everything that the feds are saying, basically, as Ontario's stance. What the feds say is what we're going to do. And what the province says is what we're going to do. So, you know, Wynn is saying, you know, government says 4 plants per person per household. Okay, that's what it is. But, yeah, you know, now, we'll see.
Now, I see they got no price set. That's all coming down with the government, which we'll talk about here in a second.
Yeah.
It's too bad that now also we see recently over the last day or two there's been some amendments to Bill C-45, the Cannabis Act.
Yeah, a lot happened at that premier's meeting with Trudeau. Apparently, you know, a lot of concerns I think were voiced at that meeting. A couple of them look like they're being addressed. My hat off again, once again, to Don Davies, our savior in arms up there in Parliament Hill. You know, he's really pushing for, you know, equal rights under this new act. And it looks like we're going to lose the centimeter height on plants. They're saying you cannot regulate how high a plant is going to grow. And looks like perhaps the feds are seeing the light on that. And
looks like an unlimited height.
Yeah, which makes far more sense when you're talking about a plant.
Yeah. Now, there's been another amendment as well to all this. Oh, not amendment, sorry. Well, sort of, I don't know if it would be an amendment or an announcement. And that was the fact that 1 year, it was written up as an amendment. 1 year after cannabis legalization, then they would bring in the edibles.
Yeah, they say.
Where we've been sort of going, like, whereas is that? We haven't known that. Now they have given us a bit of a date on it.
Yeah, maximum 1 year. So it could happen in 6 months.
Correct. You
know, a maximum amount of time for them to introduce edibles into this legalization platform will be 12 months from legalization date. So whatever date they come up with to put this forward, they have 12 months from them or less to allow edibles on the market and in retail stores. They mention concentrates, which is awesome. Now, these kind of amendments that are coming out are encouraging. You know, that maybe they're seeing the light. You know, maybe enough pushback is happening where they're saying, hey, you know, really, we're being a little bit ridiculous here. We're going to have to loosen these reins a little bit in order for this to work. And I hope that safe consumption sites and dispensaries also work their way into
that. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Because we need a spot to be able to consume, you know, just...
Absolutely.
You can't restrict a person to their home.
Absolutely. And public pressure, I think, and public education and education of our own ministers and our own regional representatives and so forth and our members of our community that are representing us in the House of Commons, you know, education to them is paramount here. And I think that's the catalyst that's pushing this forward. And it's so important for the general public and the listeners at large to keep up that pressure. Continue sending the letters to your members and to your MPPs and to your MPs, all levels of parliament and government that your region is involved with. This kind of pressure is working, and the education is working, and we're seeing some change.
Yes, we are. We certainly are. You know, like that amendment of the plant height was...
I actually saw
it on Twitter. Kirk Tusaw had responded to somebody else's post about it. So it was good to see that. Now, the last thing that I want to mention before we bring in our guest is, I don't know whether you've seen the thing Trudeau has talked about, the taxes on the cannabis.
Yeah, the biggest downfall of the amendments and the revisions that are coming out and the announcements. I mean, this is going to be their failure. They're talking about a 10% tax, which will be on top of your regional taxes. So if you're in a province that pays GST and PST, you will have GST, PST plus 10%, or $1 if the amount is $10 or less.
Mm-hmm. Now, I've got a post here on my page from Eamon Sire of Peterborough. He says it works out to about $12.45 a gram. You buy 1 gram at a time.
Yeah. Yeah. Starting off at a $10 base price for legal government-run cannabis will be an epic failure. Once you add on all of these taxes and everything else and the limited supply, there's no way people are going to pay that when they can still go and buy a wholesale price of 1 ounce from Buddy down the road.
Yeah. Well, talking about a 30-gram OZ, $372.90 buying it through the government.
Yeah. Who's paying that for an ounce of pot?
Yeah, that's right. And the other thing that he questions as well is, how come the LPs can sell it for $10 a gram, but they sell it to patients for $17.50?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Good question. Good
Great.
Question.
Great question. And the majority of those that are selling it for the prices of $17.50, just a note to the patients out there, the majority of the companies that do have those prices are under the Canopy Growth Network.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, let's move on. I'm sure we'll be talking more about this with our guests during the program. We'll be able to compare things. So this time I'd like to welcome our guest to the program, who I described as an author, photographer and a writer, and that is our good friend, Gooey Rabinski. Welcome, Gooey, to the program. How are you doing?
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me again. Appreciate it.
Hey, we always appreciate you coming on to the show, filling us in on what's going on in the U.S., you know, being able to compare the different ways that the countries are going about legalization of cannabis. And really, probably a few years ago, Gooey, when we first met, we probably never thought we'd be really having conversations about that. You know, the two countries and how we're legalizing things.
Yeah, you know, and I saw it from the perspective of a prohibitionist state. I lived in Ohio at the time.
Yeah.
And that's one reason I would spend so much time in Toronto. It was only a 5-hour drive from Cleveland. I relocated to the West Coast, to California specifically, because this is really kind of the epicenter of the American cannabis legalization movement and industry. You know, that doesn't mean that Denver and Portland and Seattle and certainly the Bay Area, San Francisco, aren't extremely significant too. But we have these pockets in the U.S. where things are happening, and I just realized that, you know, I had to relocate if I really wanted to focus on this and helping businesses either transition from traditional industries into the cannabis industry, or new businesses launching. If I wanted to help them achieve that goal, I kind of needed to be at ground zero.
Absolutely, right, Kim?
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. I feel you there, you know, with your 5-hour drive to Toronto when you were in Ohio. I'm in that position now, originally from Toronto, and I enjoy my city very much. But living in Northern Ontario now, it's a 9-hour drive for me to Toronto or any major epicenter. Right. So I feel your need for connecting further into an epicenter, so to speak. You know, I mean, really, if you want to be fully involved and immersed and, you know, launch a business and that sort of thing, you really do need to be at one of the major centers.
Yeah, there's a lot of exciting things happening in Southern California, and it's so dynamic because there's such a population density here. I mean, the LA metro area, depending on how you define it, has between 10 and 14 million residents. So if we tag it at 12 to 14 million, largest metropolitan area in North America, but it's split up into dozens and dozens of jurisdictions, both in terms of villages and cities, you know, municipalities, also counties, and now the state is kicking in their own regulations. So it's getting extremely confusing for businesses and the lawyers and CPAs and people like me, technical writers, compliance documentation specialists who are helping them either, you know, launch a cannabis business or maintain and be profitable as a cannabis business. There's so many different ways of doing it here because those regulations vary from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, and there are so many jurisdictions.
Yeah.
It's a real interesting case study right now on what's going on.
You know, that's sort of been some of the questions up here. Has been, you know, how much difference is there going to be between province to province, sort of like what you guys are experiencing in the U.S., even though you're not federally legalizing it, your states are all doing it, or, you know, some of the states are doing it, and everybody's a little different, right?
Yeah, and when you wind up with so many jurisdictions having their own rules, it really becomes a spider web to navigate.
Oh, it's very complicated. There's attorneys in L.A. getting $500 an hour to give, like, basic information to clients who are just so confused they don't even know where to start.
Yeah, yeah, and that's where people like you come in. I mean, your kind of expertise in this and the amount of work that it takes for you to navigate through all of these different, you know, subtle laws and rules and regulations and so forth, depending on where these people live, that must take an enormous amount. It's an enormous undertaking.
I mean, they are big projects. For example, an application for a permit or a license for a cannabis business, it varies depending on industry segment. So if they want to become a dispensary versus cultivation facility versus a manufacturing facility or a delivery business, they have to have different types of licenses. Sometimes it gets complicated enough that a different type of license gets into different zone enforcement where, okay, you know, this particular location or area of this municipality allows these types of businesses, but not other types of businesses. And we find that in other industries, too. So there's nothing, you know, special or overly restrictive about what they're doing for cannabis. It just means that really a cannabis business, they're lucky if they know how to run their business, right, and they can survive. But for these specialized services, they typically have to go out to professional ancillary people like attorneys or me.
Yeah. Wow. I know that, you know, in Canada, it's a much different air about things. We have our federal regulations, then we have our provincial regulations, and then we have our jurisdictional regulations. But there seems to be more of that in the states. You seem to have subsections besides, you know, your regions. Is it that your regions are smaller or more independent, so there's more steps? Why is there more steps there?
I mean, for, you know, statistics can be very helpful. They can also be short-sighted, so we have to be careful on how much weight we give to statistics. But if we look at the population of Canada overall, you're about 36 million. The state of California has 40 million. So that's really why it's not a competition, okay? I love Denver. I love Portland. I love Seattle. But the state of Colorado, 5.5 million people. State of California, 40 million people. Well, the state of California is the sixth largest in the world, up against Russia and the UK and Germany and China. I mean, it is a force within the global economy. And on January 1st, when the state of California turns on adult use legalization for all 40 million of those people, it will become the epicenter. It's going to be a very large market influencer in terms of how policy for cannabis regulation is formed in the United States.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. So in California right now, you guys are coming up on an election shortly, and cannabis policy is a large portion of that upcoming election, right?
Well, really where we stand in California is we've got draft regulations for most industry segments right now. Like testing came out a couple months ago, and the draft regs were very restrictive. You know, I talked to the owners and managers of quite a few different testing, companies here in California, and they said, wow, this has become the daily reality. Our operational costs are going to go through the roof, and it's really going to be a huge barrier to entry for new players in the industry segment, which, of course, is not good. Competition is good for consumers and for end clients, right? It gives them a higher level of service because of the competition. So we've got things like that. You know, the regulations not only are draft, but they vary by industry segment. And some people are happy and some people obviously are not.
Yeah, for sure. So what is there more opportunities? Well, obviously, there's a lot more opportunities on the West Coast, but for where you guys are in California, in comparison to where we are, say, on the BC side and on Canadian side of the border on the West Coast, What are the main differences between California and BC in terms of the way things are being handled right now?
One thing that's making it very difficult for businesses to get into the industry is just the uncertainty. Because there's some very solid business models out there. I don't care if you're in Vancouver, BC, or if you're in the United States. A solid business model, given the current, you know, market landscape and regulatory landscape, a solid business model is a solid business model. But a lot of those great business models need funding. That the one thing they're lacking is capitalization, right? Businesses don't launch themselves for free. So it might cost $50,000 US to launch that company. It might cost $400,000 or $4 million, you know, but depending on the scope of that business plan, it costs quite a bit of money. And the one thing that both Canada and the US have in common is that institutional and individual investors are very hesitant to put their money into our respective cannabis industries right now. Because of the uncertainty, you know, nobody, I mean, it's just common sense. Nobody wants to drop a couple $100,000 of their life savings on investing in a business, and then a jurisdiction is going to say, oh, well, we're outlawing that type of business, so you can't be here at all.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. But isn't there also some your problems with the people who are going to invest that much money, and then it comes to the banking issues?
Yeah, banking's a big one.
Yeah, merchant banking, that's another huge headache. Some people are starting to get around that. You can, there is one of the nicest, most professional chains of dispensaries here in Los Angeles is MedMen. They've got national press. I've shopped at their dispensary. It's actually walking distance. So they've got several locations here in LA, but the one in West Hollywood is actually walking distance from where I live. And, they really, have their act together very well. We have all these merchant banking challenges, but MedMen has actually managed to, you can swipe your plastic in there. Now this has taken a lot of patchwork on their part, 0.8% of them. But MedMen is proof that they're finally starting to get around that. You know, I hate to think of the complexity and cost involved in a simple thing like swiping your Visa card at MedMen, but it's nice to know that there are companies that are focused on customer service and taking the burden on themselves and saying, okay, we're not just going to sit around and whine about the state of affairs in Washington, D.C., and the lack of merchant banking. Entrepreneurial ancillary services are kicking in and saying, hey, we'll find a workaround. We'll provide you with merchant banking services. They're saying that to retail companies like dispensaries. And the smart dispensaries are helping make that happen, right? Because they realize it's about all about customer service.
Yeah, for sure. Well, the more services that you can offer, the more customers are going to come through the door. That's a given in any business. The feds in the United States seem to be at the heart of the issues with banking, going so far as to threaten countries like Uruguay for using the banking system there to process medical cannabis transactions.
They didn't come after us, have they?
Yeah.
Because our transactions are...
Yeah, well, now, our CIBC, or no, RBC, and I believe Toronto Dominion Bank pulled transaction records and banking systems from a legal producer.
Yeah, sure, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This all seems to be driven by the United States. see any changes in that territory up in you guys' way with government?
Well, we're always the troublemakers, aren't we?
The block. Well, not you personally, Hunt, but...
I mean, you've got a real split here because in many respects, the United States is leading the way in cannabis legalization, right? And I mean, that's not to put down what's going on in Uruguay or Spain or the United Kingdom or certainly in Canada. I mean, if you guys, here in a few months, you get federal legalization of adult use, that's an amazing milestone. And, all the advocates and activists in Canada should be very proud of that achievement. But yeah, America's ironic because we, we're really pioneers in this space and we've done some amazing things, but at the federal level, we put up roadblocks for the entire world.
Yeah. That's the thing that's mind-boggling. You know, you, your people, your individual states, you as a people are pushing so far ahead and advancing the movement and saying, hey, this is what I want. But your government on a federal level just is not at all listening.
Exactly. I mean, if, you know, I'm not going to be a conspiracy theorist or necessarily anti-government, but if you take the idea of a democracy being representative of the will of the people and the politicians being representatives, they, you know, they are elected to represent not their own will or their vested interest, but the will of their constituents and the people that they represent. If that was the case, we would have had federal legalization a few years ago here in the United States. Continuous surveys and studies, you know, by MPP and Normal and major media outlets and survey organizations, Gallup and such, reveal that the majority of Americans want adult use legalization. If you ratchet it up to medical, then you get in the 80s and 90s, you know, 90% of Americans are like, well, of course sick people should be able to medicate, and it's just the plant.
Yeah.
Right, but we've got 100 years of stigma and propaganda and misinformation that's unfortunately just blatantly technically incorrect. Going back over 100 years here in the States, I know federal level prohibition, which happened August 1937 in the States, that was clearly 80 years ago. But the first anti-cannabis law in the United States was in 1914 in El Paso, Texas. So yeah. We've had this stigma against cannabis and against the people who have cannabis in their pockets, and in El Paso it was Mexicans, right? You know, the rich white European Americans didn't like the Mexicans. Quite frankly, they didn't like the Mexican men dating the white women. Much of what it came down to, and prohibiting cannabis was a way of easily deporting or locking up those people, and now they're not dating your daughters anymore, right?
Yeah, yep. That's right. That's how it all began, you know, with discrimination.
Yeah.
I mean, that's at the heart.
Yeah, well, we've got 100 years of that, so it's tough.
Yeah, for sure. It took us 100 years to get here. It's going to take us a while to get the hell out, that's for sure.
Yeah, exactly. I've said the same thing up here, the people that, you know, 100 years of propaganda and misinformation, all of a sudden from them to do a Wayne 80, is pretty hard, I think, for them to do. Another thing that I find odd, too, is we've been listening to 100 years of these stories, propaganda and everything, and what cannabis can do to us. But here we are on the ledge of legalization, and the only message we're hearing from them about being dangerous to people is to our youth's developing brain until they're 25. But I found it odd. I saw a quote there by the Canadian Pediatric Association stating that most of the brain development is done by the time the person is 18.
That's right. That's exactly right, Al.
But yeah, the person is 25. Go ahead, Gooey.
Yeah, you know, I can't wait till we get solid research on that because, you know, that's probably the most common, you know, I'm doing a lot of compliance documentation these days. I'm less of the, you know, traveling around North America as kind of a reporter or writing for High Times or anything like that. But the most common question we asked people was, when did you start consuming cannabis? And the average age, the youngest was 9, and the average is 13 or 14. It was 14 for me. I found many other people, regardless of gender, regardless of age. It's about 14 years old when they start. I don't know. I'm sure some of my friends and relatives would argue about the capacity of my brain, but I don't feel like consuming a whole lot of cannabis during my life has done anything to retard my cognitive capabilities. So I really would like to see some hard research on this because it's just starting to sound like a bunch of BS, you know, that if a 12-year-old smokes joints, that it's going to melt their brain. Come on, it just comes off as the same kind of fear-mongering. It's a chemistry. It's a science. If the government feels that strongly about it, then don't be wimps. Let's get this research out in the open and let's see the reality. But obviously, you know, the politics go a lot deeper than that.
Oh, I couldn't agree more, Gooey. I've been smoking since I was 14 as well. My husband started when he was 12. You know, I don't think that there's anything wrong with my brain in particular. I think I can carry a conversation, and I'm fairly well educated. You know, I can speak for myself, and you know, I don't have any issues with my head or with my personality in any sort of way that I'm aware of. Anyway, so right. I totally dispute that as well. Most of the people that I know started when they were in their teens. You know, 14, 15 years old is the average age around here when everybody started. And there's nothing wrong with any of us.
Right, right. And, you know, there's that age-old argument that would you, and this is great for people who actually have children, would you rather see your kids smoking a joint or drinking a bottle of whiskey?
Well, I can answer that, and it's smoking a joint, and that was the rule in our house. I mean, if you wanted to do something, and when the kids were of a reasonable age where I thought they could mentally absorb what they were doing, and that has, may I point out, nothing to do with their physical age, because every kid is different. But when they were mentally capable, and they were, you know, responsible enough to want to do something like that, the first rule was you do it at home first and you get it from me, because then I know what you've got.
Safety for
sure. Nice.
Yes. Yeah. My children were, kind of my younger ones. So, right. As far as, it was the legal issue, right? For them, so.
Yeah. Well, you're lucky. All three were curious.
well, I had one of the three.
Three curious kitties, man.
Yeah. Okay, guys, it's time for us to go for a break. And during the break, being that it's autumn and it's harvest time and everything, I thought we'd listen to a little bit of Grim Skunk and their song Autumn Flowers, and see what that's all about. When we get back, we'll continue our talk with Gooey Rabinski. You're talking to the Pace Radio here at lifestyleradio.net as well as .ca.
Rock and roll.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
Canada, the time to act is now. These days, your customers are seeking variety. Increase your earning potential by expanding your inventory with CC Nexus, Canada's largest cannabis seed wholesaler. CC Nexus stocks over 60 reputable breeders, including Canuck Seeds, with a wealth of auto flower, regular, feminized, and CBD strains. All first-time customers will receive a free pack of Canuck Seeds, plus a mug, t-shirt, and additional promotional materials. Add strains and increase your profit with CC Nexus, your Canadian-owned and operated wholesaler of cannabis seeds. Discreet, worldwide stealth shipping from Canada, supporting you locally. Call today, 1-844-843-7995, 1-844-843-7995, or visit us at ccnexus.global.
The following is a public service announcement from the Canadian Therapeutic Cannabis Partners Society. The Canadian Therapeutic Cannabis Partners Society is a non-profit organization dedicated to ensuring improved access to therapeutic cannabis and cannabis byproducts in Canada. With a federal government that has committed to legalizing cannabis, we feel it is our duty to ensure that the medicinal use of cannabis doesn't get lost in the process and that there are clear distinctions made between the medicinal and recreational use of cannabis. It is our mission to ensure that government regulation doesn't get in the way of a sick, disabled, or terminally ill person's right to use or produce this amazing natural health product. If you would like to get involved, you can contact us on the internet. www.canadiantherapeuticcannabispartners.com, on Facebook, CTCP Society, or search Canadian Therapeutic Cannabis Partners.
CTCP now operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
Man, have you been to Canna Days yet?
Canna Days.
Campbellford's premier cannabis culture shop at 19 Bridge Street West. They've got bongs, oil rigs, grinders, and papers. Everything you need for consumption. They've got seeds, soil, nutrients, and dome trays too. Everything you need for cultivation. Get top quality seeds from top suppliers like Canuck and wholesaler Nexus. Canna Days. They've got all kinds of awesome cannabis novelties, clothing, and apparel. I know, right? It's a lot more than just a bong shop. Interested in gaining legal access? Yay.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person by phone or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
BMA offers cannabinoid testing, so if you want to prove you've got good medicine, head to BMA Hydroponics and prove it.
Hello and welcome back. We are the Pace Radio Show and we are live here at lifestyleradio.net as well as at Spreaker, TuneIn Radio, and Showcast. Catch the coffee and cannabis with Tamarijuana everywhere. It's tongue twister for me. Wednesdays at 9 p.m., 9 a.m. Mountain Time, 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and the 420 Radio Show, Friday night, 7 o'clock, with the 420 crew, and always some zany things happen during that show every once in a while. So catch them Friday and Wednesdays. Tonight, here on the program, Gooey, Rabinski and Kim Cooper are here with me, and we're talking everything about cannabis.
Sorry,
Kim.
Yeah, we sure are. With our friends from south of the border in sunny California.
It is sunny. You know, the one thing I can really rely on here is typically in the 70s and sunny skies. I've seen about 3 minutes of rain in the last 5 months, so I kind of love it here.
Oh, I'm so jealous.
Yeah.
I need a vacation. Come and crash on your couch for 5 days and enjoy some sun.
I will try. You know, I would just say, I shouldn't say this. This is not very good, but don't follow my Instagram like during the winter months for those of you who get snow and cold temps, because that's when you're really going to get pissed off.
Yeah. That's right.
Those days are pretty much upon me where I live, so.
You're going to be like, is that a bikini top? It's January. What the hell?
Yeah. Well, we were seeing some bikinis last week. We were into some cold weather this week on time.
Yeah. It's not been nice in Canada these days, but that's pretty much anywhere. But anyway, on a lighter note. So, Gooey, Mr. Rabinski, Mr. Writer, Photographer, Entrepreneur, Man of many, many, many talents, my friend. You've traveled in many places. You started up an entrepreneurial business. Now you're helping people do their thing in your region. the web and weaving their way through the maze stuff going on with California regulations, and it's just such a spider web. We touched on it a little bit. Give us an overview of basically what would somebody come to you for?
They can come to me for quite a few things, actually. You know, forget the cannabis industry for a second, and, you know, it's got a lot of unique roadblocks, quite frankly, a lot of unique barriers to entry. But there's just certain pieces, parts, especially in terms of documentation and diligence, that have to be committed on the part of a company of any size. You know, they've got to have a business plan. They've got to have an operational plan. And if they want a permit or a license to operate a cannabis-specific business, then they have to have sometimes it's a conditional use permit. Sometimes it's a different kind of license or permit from a legal perspective. But there's, you know, and these are not three-page documents, right? Some applications for permits, depending on the jurisdiction, and they tend to be a little bigger if it's for a U.S. state instead of a municipality or a county. But municipalities and counties are all kind of copying each other, so they're getting much more complicated and asking for a lot more detail these days, too. Those are sometimes 200-page, very complicated documents. You know, they're $10,000 to $50,000 documents, quite honestly. And they involve a lot of different people, not just technical writers and researchers like me. They involve attorneys. They typically involve CPAs. You know, if you have a business plan and you have to have a 3 to 5 year pro forma, in other words, a prediction of your financial performance and where you're going to spend your money and where you anticipate making your profits, and how you're going to reinvest those profits, or whether you're going to distribute to shareholders, or, you know, all that detail is in that pro forma. That's part of the business plan. And you think, wow, there's business plan is just one of kind of the three core documents, business plan, operational plan, and then, again, your applications for a permit or license, which, again, depending on where you live, you might need three of those. And if they're $20,000, $25,000 a piece, oh, wow. So to start a cannabis business, you've got to have almost $100,000 just to pay attorneys and someone to write the applications. In the right circumstances, that's true. And it's like you were saying earlier, Kim, depending on the industry segment someone's getting into, depending on exactly where their property is located, you know, all these other conditional elements here, those people might be able to get into the industry fairly inexpensively. You know, what does that mean? $10,000, $50,000? I just did a manufacturing application for a client in Costa Mesa here in the Los Angeles area a couple weeks ago, and their application fee was $50,000.
Wow.
Half of which is a non-refundable straight-up application fee. The other $25,000 is a recurring processing fee. So every year, if they win, now this is if they win. If they lose, they don't get their $25,000 back. If they win, they owe another $25,000 for a total of $50,000, and then a year later, another $25,000. Year later, another $25,000. Those are not taxes. Those are processing fees and application fees. Taxes are completely in addition to that.
So, I mean, a lot of people think, you know, out on the West Coast, oh, go to California, it's easy. Just, you know, rent a storefront and open a shop.
Sure, yeah, exactly.
Right? Simple as that. That's how it works, right?
Go West, young man. Yeah, get rid of selling weed, yep.
Yeah, not quite that freaking easy, is it?
No, there's a cost to doing business regardless of your business segment, regardless of your location. There are very basic things, right? And, I mean, I think kind of the sad part, what we're going to see in the next few years is there are some extremely talented cultivators out there, extraction artists, you know, people making concentrates, people making edibles. There's some very talented people in the market with compassion for patients or with a certain, desire as an advocate or an activist. But if they don't have basic business skills or someone on their team or they hire out those skills, you know, but if they cannot balance a spreadsheet, if they cannot, you know, cross their T's and dot their I's and satisfy government inspectors who sometimes do surprise inspections. Some of these jurisdictions, even here in progressive California, will give you a 24-hour notice on an inspection. Others will actually do a surprise inspection. They'll just show up at your door and say, all right, show us your farm or we're going to shut you down.
Yeah, we have that here as well. We're under the same sort of regulations. If you're registered as an LP here, or a quote-unquote LP is a legal producer, which is a certified producer by the Government of Canada. Health Canada comes in, and they do all of their inspections and this and that, and you have to have your warehouse space up and running and all of the lights and all of the electricity and all of the security and everything like that for, you know, up to a year or more operational before you even get your permit. You know, you're into the millions upon millions of dollars before they even put a seed in the ground.
Right.
So, right. I mean, it's the same situation in Canada for legal producers, right, Al?
Yeah, it is. If you hear a little bit of noise, I'm outside right now.
Yeah.
But if you're talking about surprise inspections, they've done that here, and that's how they caught some of the last rounds of pesticides being used.
That's right. Legal producers have had recalls, and they've nailed some of the companies having pesticides on site, and it was largely due to the surprise inspections.
Wow, interesting. Very interesting.
Yes, it is. And you know, once they got caught without the inspections, and that was, you know, through testing, they started those surprise tests. It's too bad they didn't do them earlier, because, you know, that's patients, that's medication, right?
Yeah, who knows, you know, how much tainted medication was coming out of those, being churned out of there for years on end. You know, it wasn't until the surprise inspection located a product on the property that shouldn't have even been on the property because it's a banned substance. Then they did some surprise testing on the product and found the product contained the banned substance. So now, along with surprise inspections, they also do surprise testing of product while they're on site.
Yeah, which I think is good stuff, because consumer health and safety has to be job one. You know, you can't have someone who's got stage 4 cancer, they're consuming this as medicine. I realize that's just part of the market. You know, the future market is mostly going to be adult use / recreational. But if you know, anytime you have a human being or a pet putting something into their body that could potentially harm them, especially when they can, you know, they're interpreting it as medicine, I think we really, probably the number one thing, when we look back on this 50 years from now, where we are now, I think we're going to look back and say the number one thing we're getting in place is testing and infrastructure for testing that ensures the purity of the end product.
Oh, absolutely, 100% testing and research, that's where it's at. You know, research on all of, like we were discussing earlier, you know, they say the causes and this and that and the other thing. Where's the research to back up these causes? Where's the research to back up the proof for cures? Where's, you know, the research for all of it? The clinical research needs to be done, and, you know, the restraints and the handcuffs have to come off the plant in order to accomplish that.
Yeah, and it does get very interesting in that respect. Like, okay, California's had medical cannabis for 20 years, right, since 1996 with the Compassionate Use Act or Prop 215, and you get your medical card. And so it's like it's been in Canada for a long time, almost as long, where the justification for you not getting busted for possessing or consuming cannabis is that you have an illness to treat, right? The interesting, as we see the regulations unfolding here in California for adult use recreational, okay, not medical, we're finding that in products like edibles, we're actually setting regulations that say vendors and manufacturers of edibles cannot claim health benefits. Now, is this kind of ironic, even paradoxical?
There's only health benefits if you smoke it.
it was like, you know, that was the only way to legally get your hands on it. And now, you know, they're saying, oh, but if you're going to sell cookies, which are arguably, you know, edibles are among the healthiest. Many hardcore patients prefer edibles, right? But you can't say that they'll improve your health. And I'm just like, wow, you know, society regulation of itself is very entertaining.
I'm sure that I believe the LPs have something like that up here where they can't make claims without backing it up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. There's no proof to back up your claim, so you can't say it's healthy. Even though we're using it as a prescription to treat your ailment, we can't say it's helping your ailment because there's no research to back that up.
Yeah. There's just so much nudge, nudge, wink, wink. It's insane.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's probably one of the most researched plants out there, but yet there's no research. But if there's no research, how can they claim that there's developing brain issues?
Yeah, I know. It's a vicious freaking circle. It really is. We've been using it in medicine for thousands of years. It's on the books. You know, prior to 1914, it was in the Book of Pharmacology in the United States and Canada.
That's right.
So, I mean, you know, the research is there. I mean, and don't let anybody tell you it's not.
I want to just jump back with a question on the testing down there, Gooey.
Yeah.
Far as, like, you're involved in these things, are you seeing different requirements from state to state? Is it all pretty standard?
No, it's absolutely not standard, and that's part of what's creating so much confusion in the American cannabis industry. But like we're saying, even if you just relegate it to Southern California, there's so many jurisdictions. But Oregon handles it differently than California. Again, California just has proposed regulations. They are not final currently. They may change a little. They may change a lot. We'll see on the feedback cycle, right? Washington State is different. Denver is different. Denver is currently modifying their law for edibles, and they're setting the rules. Of course, you know, the number one thing is that they don't want edibles to mimic candy and appeal to children. So sometimes I think reasonable regulations are being set up. Other times, they're really, really tight regulations that, you know, you can't get at all into a cartoonish zone in terms of logos and packaging. They want to be very, very certain that minors aren't, you know, going to, child's not going to reach into the pantry and pull out the wrong cookie.
I find that troublesome, you know, in a lot of ways, because, you know, that comes down to the person that is of legal age who owns that particular product to do their due diligence and handle that with care and make sure it's out of reach of the child. The same as we do for a bottle of vitamins. A bottle of Flintstone vitamins have wonderful character shapes on them, and the kids are attracted to them from the cartoons.
Good point.
And that bottle of Flintstone vitamins will kill that kid. And a baggie of gummy-shaped gummy bears that are cannabis-infused will not. So what's
good point? I haven't heard that example. That's great. You know, the vitamins, everybody wouldn't think anything wrong with that.
So it's up to us parents to keep those vitamins up on a high shelf away from the children. Why isn't it the same regulation for cannabis infused edibles?
Well, a friend of mine owns a company in Portland, and she does topicals. And, you know, relatively benign. They can have a lot of medical efficacy, but it's not like you're drinking them, you know. And she's had to spend tens of thousands of dollars repackaging her product just to make it childproof under Oregon's laws. And it's actually putting people out of business. You know, this is a serious issue, and I'm not saying that we should get sloppy with it and let, you know, four-year-olds eat a cookie and go into a two-day coma or something like that, right?
Yeah.
It's not going to kill them, but this is a serious issue. It's sad that we act as if it could kill the children. You know, it won't kill your dog. It won't kill your child. It won't kill you. It won't even hurt you. It just might give you a nap or the munchies. But that, you know, there's, and again, this is what you're saying. We need to get back to the science. But anyway, my point was, like, in terms of my friend in Oregon, we're having such tight regulations that we're putting businesses, good, honest, tax-paying businesses, we're putting them out of business because we're getting somewhat sometimes, I think, ridiculous in how tight these regulations are. It's like you're saying, Kim, how careful can we be, and how much does the state, through its regulations, have to be a control nanny
Shouldn't parents, you know, they're the legal custodians of the children, you know, shouldn't they show some care in ensuring that those cookies don't get found, like you're saying?
Well, that's it. You can't mandate common sense. You can't, you know, enforce these kind of laws that are going to restrict people from using common sense, their own brains, and our free will to make a choice. You know, and that's what it's coming down to. You know, you're mandating parenting.
Yeah, I was going to say, there's no laws or regulations that tells you where you have to keep your pharmaceutical drugs within your house.
No, you know, but common sense tells us that, you know, we all have a liquor cabinet, right? You know, we've got kids in the house. Every parent has a frickin' liquor cabinet. And if there's booze in the house, all the booze is in the liquor cabinet so we can keep track of it. You know, the meds are in the medicine cabinet. You know, like that's what all of these cabinets in our homes are named for. And we all have them, you know, and it comes down to common sense and proper parenting.
Yeah,
it is. And unfortunately, some people don't provide that, and people end up...
Well, mandating the rest of us to punish the few is no way to go up.
No, that's right. Exactly.
Well, it's unfortunate, but on that topic of, you know, common sense, this is kind of a culture war, you know, and there are conservative forces that do not want cannabis to be part of society in any way, shape, or form. They buy into the propaganda of the last century, and they don't like it, right? They consider cannabis consumers to be dirty hippies or trashy people. There's just a lot of stigma there. And so we do see regulations and defiance to cannabis legalization that defy logic, defy science, and defy reason, right? Because kind of like we want to see it legalized, and you'll hear people in the industry and the culture say, and we'll do it any way we can, right? We feel desperate. Yep. Well, I think, you know, the conservative forces that oppose legalization, they kind of feel desperate too. If they buy into the propaganda, they think it is poison and they think it is a threat to their children and their communities. And so if they buy into that with ignorance, they are obviously going to oppose cannabis, and they'll oppose it any way they can. If they can shut it down through ridiculously tight regulations that just outprice people who want to play in the market, right? It's like, gosh, it's $300,000 to start a cannabis business. I guess we're not going to do that, honey.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's a friggin' shame, you know, because that's what's going to keep the underground market alive. That's what's going to keep, you know, patients wondering if they've got proper products. You know, it'll allow for, you know, the ones coming in that have a tainted product to get it into the system and get it into, you know, people's shelves and stuff like that, because we'll still be with an underground market and an unregulated market. So it's a bloody shame, because there's nothing that can be done about it. Whether they allow this to happen or they don't, it's going to happen, because it's already happening. It's already in our homes. We're already keeping it away from our kids. We've already been using gummy bear-shaped edibles for 20 years, and it hasn't been a problem, you know? Yeah. So no matter how much they regulate it or go up against it, all it's going to do is keep it underground.
The government's trying to catch up to a market that's already been existing for so long.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. I mean, the gummy bears are already on our shelves, and everything's
well,
been fine.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes we get into these discussions and arguments, and they're overly theoretical, okay? For example, when an individual state legalizes cannabis for adult use, okay, everybody don't have to have medical necessity. You can all go buy joints and smoke joints, and, you know, under certain regulations, you can engage in all of that. And we act as if the black market is suddenly just going to go away. But here's the problem in the U.S., and this dynamic exists in Canada and everywhere else, too. Okay, so we take these 40 million people in California, and we make it all legal for them to possess and consume. But we've got all these other states in the nation, states where people are willing to pay $400, $500, $550 for an ounce of mediocre weed that maybe would not be top shelf in the California market, But boy, it fetches a whole lot of money, more than it does in the home production market, when we ship it out to the Midwest. So as long as there are just a couple of states that prohibit adult use, all these other states that are known for producing cannabis, oh, you know, they might be 2 pounds out the front door through the track and trace system and 1 pound out the back door, right? There will always be a black market, because there's so much freaking profit to be made by a legal state where production goes up, prices go down, and now we have a cheaper, a lower cost per unit, but that cost is still jacked up artificially high because of prohibition out in the, you know, in the prairie provinces, as you Canadians would call them, in Ohio and Kentucky and Alabama. And that's what's going to happen. There will always be a black market until we have every single hectare of freaking North America legal. As well, there will always be a black market, because people in the legal areas will see an economic opportunity by brokering it and shipping it into the illegal areas.
Oh, for sure. We see it here already. You know, with LP weed making it out the back door, so to speak. You know, and showing up on the black market, you know, in people's homes and stuff. So it's happening here.
Right.
But...
Oh, hey guys. And it happened rampant.
Yeah.
It's for
break time.
Time for break. Just time for break. Got a customer in here, too. You hear that in the background, I'm sure.
Yep.
All right. We're going to hear some more of the song Autumn Flowers. As we know, it's that season. And then we're going to continue our talk with Gooey Rabinski. You're listening to the Pace Radio Show here at lifestylradio.net as well as .ca. See you on the other side in 5.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
Watch the sunset, sipping wine. Share this meal, good friend of mine. Twilight comes, let your mind rest. Partake in this kind harvest.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person, by phone, or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exempt MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
BMA offers cannabinoid testing, so if you want to prove you've got good medicine, head to BMA Hydroponics and prove it.
Man, have you been to Canna Days yet?
Canna Days.
Campbellford's premier cannabis culture shop at 19 Bridge Street West. They've got bongs, oil rigs, grinders, and papers. Everything you need for consumption. They've got seeds, soil, nutrients, and dome trays too. Everything you need for cultivation. Get top quality seeds from top suppliers like Canuck, Crop King, and wholesaler Nexus. Canna Days. They've got all kinds of awesome cannabis novelties, clothing, and apparel. I know, right? It's a lot more than just a bong shop. Interested in gaining legal access? Canna Days can help. They're a PACE information center. You know, people advocating cannabis education? Come by the shop and check it out. 19 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
Canna Days.
Have your say without saying a word. CannaDays.ca.
Hi, this is Al Graham of the Pace Radio Show. Are you keeping pace, as in keeping people advocating cannabis education? If you're not, and you're a cannabis consumer, then why not? Others are working hard every day to help educate people about cannabis so you can enjoy your daily 420. Get involved and speak out. Be loud and proud so that you can keep pace. Tune into the Pace Radio Show every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time to hear about people advocating cannabis education here on lifestyleradio.ca.
Canada, the time to act is now. These days, your customers are seeking variety. Increase your earning potential by expanding your inventory with CC Nexus, Canada's largest cannabis seed wholesaler. CC Nexus stocks over 60 reputable breeders, including Canuck Seeds, with a wealth of auto flower, regular, feminized, and CBD strains. All first-time customers will receive a free pack of Canuck Seeds, plus a mug, t-shirt, and additional promotional materials. Add strains and increase your profit with CC Nexus, your Canadian-owned and operated wholesaler of cannabis seeds. Discreet, worldwide stealth shipping from Canada, supporting you locally. Call today, 1-844-843-7995, 1-844-843-7995, or visit us at ccnexus.global.
Hey, thanks for tuning in to the program, everybody. As always, I'd like to remind everybody we are being broadcasted at lifestyleradio.ca as well as .net. If you miss out on these live programs, and you know, I realize people are working, or you know, you don't have online radio in the car, so you can always catch the podcast afterwards at Mixcloud, YouTube, as well as iTunes. Tonight, for our music, we featured Grim Skunk and the band, who are based in Quebec, and they were around earlier before the turn of the century, so they've been around for a while. And we got to hear a bit of the song Autumn Flowers. Sorry about the noise in the background. We're in a business. If you liked it, then I suggest that you enter Grim Skunk into your favorite search engine. Today on the Pastry Show, we are joined by our guests, Gooey Rabinski and Kim Cooper. Gooey, Kim, we're going into the last segment here, and I'm sure you've got something you need our listeners to know, Kim.
Yes, I do. Just before we wrap up with Gooey, who is always fantastic to talk to, for sure. Such insights from south of the border. Gooey, you know, you're known for traveling around the world and writing for various publications like Skunk Magazine is one of them, High Times, various magazines, far too many to mention. But you've kind of going in a new direction. You've got your new enterprise where you're doing your consultations with businesses. But your passion for writing, that hasn't died, but you're taking it in a brand new direction with a new project.
Yeah, I stood back, and I've been doing this for the last year, 2 years, and I looked at my freelance career, and, I've had some wonderful clients, Herb.co, Wostork, Mary Jane, like you're saying, all the print publications like High Times and Cannabis Culture. Cannabis Culture has done some amazing things, you know, in Canada to educate people for a long time, right? And that was actually the first cannabis magazine I wrote for back in 2004, back when Dana Larson was the editor and did such a great job. But, as legalization takes hold and these regulations go into place, I'm tuning so much of my effort into compliance documentation. It's not real sexy stuff, these, 150-page permit applications or, 180-page business plan, but it's definitely needed. And if a new store is going to pop up in my neighborhood, it could be a liquor store, it could be a bar, it could be a church, it could be a dispensary. And if I can, make a living and help that dispensary get a retail location and start a viable business and feed their family and the families of their employees, that's kind of the world that I would like to see manifest. But on the writing side, yeah, we still have a problem, right? People are ignorant. I hear all the time that doctors need credible information. They don't know where to turn. They go to 420whatever.com, and if it's a whole Cheech and Chong culture, quite frankly, that doesn't make them comfortable, Soccer moms from the suburbs don't like the whole, huge joint Cheech and Chong culture. These are parents. These are relatively moderate or sometimes even conservative suburbanites or people in small towns, and it doesn't mean that they don't like cannabis. We need to, you know, we need to get away from that stigma. There are millions of Republicans who totally love cannabis, right? But these people need to understand, hey, I heard there's this terpene and it kills cancer. Is that true?
Yeah.
How do you get information like that? So I'm trying to work with some people in the industry, and we're trying to put our arms around like a compendium of information. Like if you had a few hundred articles about different cannabis topics and they all tied together, and they provided, you know, a basic level of information for doctors, for anyone in the industry. I mean, let's face it, we've got real estate agents who are like, hey, I'm going to do cannabis real estate, and I'm going to make a mint, right? And they jump into this industry. Do they really understand the herb/vegetable that they're working with, right? Maybe they're not hands-on. They're not actually a cultivation facility. But they're an ancillary service that kind of needs to understand the chemistry of the plant, I think.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. That's a much-needed resource, for sure. And I know what you mean about that. And you find that a lot, especially on social media. You know, a lot of people will start on social media. You just type in cannabis, and you come up with these different groups and stuff on social media platforms and that. And that's the first thing you see. You know, a woman with her big chest out and cannabis on
right.
it. Or Cheech and Chong, like you say, you know, sitting there, you know, getting wasted and falling off of something. You know, that's not a go-to place for information.
Yeah, I mean, probably one of the most surprising things that I've learned since coming to California more than a year ago is that the average soccer mom doesn't want that culture. It's not that they don't embrace it, but they actually do not like it. And it's one of the reasons that people, and I'm one of them, are predicting that edibles is going to be a larger market segment than flowers. You know, these people are not going to be coming home in the evening and rolling, you know, big blunts and dabbing, you know, with blowtorches and such. They're going to be eating microdosed cookies and mints. And this is the way they're going to adopt a cannabis lifestyle, whether we romanticize that or not, whether those of us who have been doing it for 20 or 30 years like that future. I think that's going to be the future, and it's going to turn out a little differently than we're anticipating, probably.
Yeah, I think so too. There's a whole section, you know, of medicinal users, non-medicinal users, the curious. You know, that aren't being, whose needs aren't being looked after as far as getting the information. It's a large section that's being largely ignored.
Well, I'm going to see what I can do about that. Instead of, like when I was writing for Waxy a couple of years ago, I was shocked when, over about a 10-month period, I did about 200 articles for them. 191 articles, to be exact, many of which were long-ass articles, like 2,800 words, just longer than anybody's going to read, and they take more time to develop, right? Well, what if you restrict the length of those articles to like 300 words or 500 words or something where it's nice and easy to digest and the average layperson can get in, read it, consume it, and get out and have knowledge and share that knowledge and go to the voting booth, you know, or the doctor or online with that knowledge. So that's really what I'm trying to manifest. So it's not just, oh, this editor wants this article this week, and this other editor wants a different article, to strategically develop, let's say, between 400 and 800 articles that all very carefully cover different areas. So as a body of information, you could point, again, a doctor or a cannabis industry, a bud tender, for example, and say, you know, even get so specific and say, go down into this subsection and drill into, say, you know, terpene technology, because that's important for your job.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. Fantastic. Well, I can't wait, you know, to see that development of that, for sure. much needed resource in our community and beyond, for sure. So, Gooey, where can people find you and find out about you and what's going on and how can they reach you?
Really, the best way is at GooeyRabinski.com. I'm getting ready to overhaul my blog and turn it into kind of a media hub, make it a little more enticing and entertaining than just the blog structure that I've got up there right now, which is it's not the best, quite honestly. There's a lot of nice content there, but it's just so me and some other people were trying to overhaul that, and all these new articles that I'm talking about would be rolled out at GooeyRabinski.com. In addition to taking a bunch of similar types of articles and rolling them up into short ebooks, for example. So, you know, you could read it on your iPad or, you know, but to get beyond a body of knowledge that's a 500-word article, and maybe you have, 30 of those 500-word articles and you string them all together into a particular type of book. It's just, you know, we got to get the information out there. The challenge becomes monetizing. Right. If you can't pay your bills and providing that information to society, then you're probably not going to be able to do it very long. So people like me were always challenged by monetizing intellectual property and content, and it's not easy.
Oh, well, that's for sure. That's for sure. I can attest to that. yeah, that's for sure. Before we go and before we end off the show here and go to our shout out and stuff, I wanted to ask you about one other thing, one other subject here. Founding Fathers to Smoke Weed. Tell me about that. You're part of that.
Oh, I recently wrote, I'm a troublemaker. I wrote an article that basically says, look, it's kind of like the existence of God. You can neither prove nor disprove the existence of God if you want to get down to strict logic, right? So based on all the evidence that I've been able to find, I didn't hang out with George Washington or Thomas Jefferson, so I wasn't actually there, right? None of us were. So we can only go on the hard research that we have available. But the conclusion of the article, and this is on my blog at GooeyRabinski.com, is that George Washington and Thomas Jefferson probably did not smoke pot, quote-unquote, okay? They were growing hemp, and the hemp had so little THC in it, they could have smoked an acre of it, and they would have had no euphoric effect whatsoever.
Now, right.
Personally, and I encourage people to go read this article, and, oh, I've gotten some people who told me I was a nutcase. People have been getting very emotional over this article. It's great. Lots of fun. But here's what really has convinced me that they probably did not smoke cannabis, you know, and get a psychotropic or, you know, euphoric effect. Because people like Thomas Jefferson and George Washington, they were prolific communicators and prolific archivists and documenters, and they loved to write and they loved to teach and they were didactic in nature. If they had experienced any of that, they would have written it down. Now, if in my scant research, if I have somehow missed that information, then I would love someone to send it to me. Hey, I think it's as romantic as everyone else that George Washington was smoking a spliff, but guess what? I don't think he was.
Very cool. Very cool.
Very cool. I noticed you posted on there that it was your most, one of your most controversial articles or something.
Yeah. You know, and maybe I was baiting. Maybe I was trying to be controversial.
Yeah. Okay, good. Okay, Kim, you had, it's what, 20 after the hour right now?
Time for shout-outs.
Well, did you want to do a shout-out or did you want to
do we can do the other thing first. We'll do the other thing first
and have Gooey involved in that if he has any comments. And
all right.
Do the shout-out afterwards. Okay.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's all your floor is yours again.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Gooey, for allowing me to take this time. For those of you that are listening that may not be aware, cannabis community suffered a loss this last weekend. Pardon me if I get emotional during this piece. Stephanie Lee Hooker was a member of the cannabis community and a friend of mine for quite some time. The girl was very troubled. She suffered from PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, affects 7 to 8 people out of every 100 in this country. There are very little resources for people with PTSD. Most counselors that try to help don't have the necessary training to adequately guide these people through their symptoms. We don't have the proper drug applications being applied to these patients. We're using medications that are not for PTSD. They're for other reasons, and they're causing these patients more distress than they would have without these drugs. Cannabis helps a lot of people with PTSD. It's not a cure. It doesn't help everybody. It can alleviate some of the symptoms. It can get you through the day. But sometimes it's just not enough to get you to carry on. And that was the case with Stephanie. Stephanie fought her demons for a very, very long time. Many people looked at Stephanie in ways that hurt me deeply, because they felt, a lot of times I heard the words, that she's faking it. She's using her illness to get ahead. Stuff like this. These are barriers that people with PTSD can't overcome. This is what causes them to go further into their depressions and further into themselves and not seek help, because of these kind of receptions that they get from some people. Guilt is the one emotion that we all feel after somebody dies, especially if you felt that you didn't do quite enough. I ask everybody that is possibly struggling with that guilt, embrace it, use it, make sure that it never happens again. Reach out to somebody in need, help somebody that needs a hand. That's about all I'd like to say, but I'd like to end off by adding, there is information at the PTSDAssociation.com. That is the PTSD Association of Canada's website. There is help available there. There is also help at the suicideprevention.ca online. I urge everybody to help somebody in need. Open your heart and look at this with some understanding. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Kim, for that. I look at it, it's like you're talking about people didn't believe Stephanie, and I didn't know Stephanie other than knowing her through Facebook. But it's a condition that people don't see. You know, if you see somebody walking with a cane, you know that they've got a cane. They've got a health issue. But you know, with PTSD or any other condition where a person doesn't physically see it, somebody from the outside doesn't physically see it, then they question things, and it's not right.
It's been a very difficult time. Steph took her own life because she couldn't cope, and that shouldn't be happening in Canada today.
Yeah, and I don't know, Gooey, do you know if down there in the U.S. where there's been, you know, any research whatsoever? Like, I know up here, I believe one of the LPs was talking about doing the research on the PTSD.
Dr. Sue Sisley here is, I encourage all of your listeners to look her up. She's all over the internet. She's one of the foremost PTSD researchers in the United States.
She's at the PACE website as well. I have her listed as one of the researchers.
Yeah. I would start with her, quite honestly. I've been wanting to interview her for like a year and a half, and it just, you know, hasn't happened yet. I have a lot of respect for Dr. Sisley's work. She networks. She gets out there. She cares. You know, she truly is one of the successful, intelligent people in this industry/culture, who truly cares about having a positive impact on people suffering from diseases like PTSD and using cannabis in some way, shape, or form in order to help themselves.
There you go. Yeah. And what was the doctor's name again, Gooey?
Sue Sisley, S-I-S-L-E-Y.
Okay, there you go. I just want to make sure that everybody caught that name. Okay, Kim, you were going to say something?
Yeah, availability is a large issue, too, for these patients. You know, a lot of, if you're not a vet, then you're not getting any deals or any discounts or any help with the cost of your medication. And the current cost of these medications to use cannabis to treat your PTSD in Canada, it's not an affordable medication for anybody who is on assistance. And if you have PTSD, guaranteed you're on assistance. So therefore, you can't afford your meds. So you wind up in a catch-22. You rotate on the cannabis, off the cannabis because you can't afford it, you're back on the pills. And then you can get some cannabis, so you go off the pills and you go on that. And it just becomes a vicious circle. And this is something that has to be resolved.
Yes, access, for sure. Big time. Yeah. Big time. Okay, Gooey, we're getting here close to the wrapping up the show, and we'd like to, you know, shout out time. If you got anybody like you'd like to throw out their website again, or person, place, patient that maybe you're dealing with, whatever.
Well, you know, I would encourage people to, again, check out Dr. Sue Sisley and the research that she's trying to do. She comes up against a lot of roadblocks here in the United States. I'd also like to encourage people to check out Mara Gordon. She's here in California, and she's one of those people who does not come from the Cheech and Chong culture. She's very much from the establishment. She's an engineer and approaches things like an engineer, but she's also very compassionate, and she and her company, Zelda Therapeutics, in Central California, they're helping people as young as 4 or 5 years old who sometimes have like Dravet syndrome, you know, hundreds of micro seizures per day that basically like wipe their brain clean. It's like wiping a slate clean. So that's why they don't progress in their development. And it's a very sad situation. We found that using sublingual tinctures and such, and the research that Mara Gordon is doing, she's helping those 4 year olds. She, one time I asked her, I said, what's the youngest and the oldest that you've helped? And she's helped people as young as 4 years old and up into their 80s. So this is, she's educating doctors and getting the medical establishment to appreciate molecules like terpenes and cannabinoids and to see it from a very scientific and very medical perspective, getting rid of all the stigma. So I would encourage people to check out Mara Gordon. I think her work is very important for pushing the industry forward.
Nice. Yeah, I haven't heard that name. I have to look that up myself. What about you, Kim?
Yeah, tonight my shout out, of course, is to Stephanie Lee Hooker. You can look her up on Facebook. I have a link to her site on my Facebook page. Stephanie, I'm dedicating tonight's show to you and to all PTSD patients out there, their families, caregivers, and those around them going through the struggle. My heart goes out to you, Justin and Michael. That's Stephanie's two boys. I'm deeply saddened by the loss of your mother. My heart goes out to you, and I wish you all the best in your futures. And also to Jay, otherwise known as Jay, is Jason Bolt, Stephanie's closest friend. My friend, I'm with you. I'm with you. That's all.
Yeah, thank you, Kim. And yes, she will be missed by many. So people loved her, and it's a sad situation. So. Okay, I will be back next week with joint host Alicia Yashishin and her guest. And you can find us on Twitter at Pace Radio. You can find us on Facebook. You can like us there. We're also on Instagram as Pace Radio Show. We're online at pace-online.ca, and that's where you can message me for some free stuff. Also, thank you as well to our sponsors, our helpful folks at BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. They're at bmahydroponics.com. CC Nexus, they're founded at ccnexus.global. They're one of Canada's largest cannabis seed wholesaler. The candidates for supplying Pace with educational center space, as well as allowing us to do the broadcast here. As you heard, the noise in the background, it was nice to have the customers come in through the store while we're on the show. Also to Al Rapp, Lifestyle Radio, for doing the program, getting us out there and allowing for a voice to be heard. Thank you to you, Gooey, coming on the show. We always appreciate to have you on. It's always great to talk to you.
I appreciate you having me. I love talking to you guys, getting the Canadian perspective and sharing what's going on in Southern California.
Yes, it's always nice to hear things. But geez, I really wish your federal government would really do something on the positive side.
Yeah, I know. I mean, you know, it's bad when I can't physically move any further away from Washington D.C. or I'll be in Tokyo.
You know, we all sit around and have sessions, and you know, you got this guy, you know, his last name Sessions, and he's against cannabis. It just doesn't make sense. And thank you to you, Kim, for the program and doing your tribute to Stephanie tonight. It's always good for people to speak out. So,
for sure.
And thank you to our listeners. It's always great to have you on board and liking the shows and listening in. So we really appreciate you. So to everybody, thank you all, and good night. We'll talk to you next week.
Thanks, guys.
Good night.
Tall and she grew up right with them Indiana boys on an Indiana night. Well, she moved down here at the age of 18. She blew the boys away, it was more than they'd seen. I was introduced and we both started grooving. She said, I dig you, baby, but I got to keep moving. One more time to kill the pain. I feel something creeping in and I'm tired of this town screwing up. I'm tired of going down. I'm tired of myself. I'm tired of this town. Oh my my. Oh hell yes. Honey, put on that party dress. Buy me a drink. Sing me a song. Take me as I come, cause I can't stay long. Last dance with Mary Jane. One more time to kill the pain. Tired of this town again. Square, she's standing in her underwear, looking down from a hotel room. The nightfall will be coming soon. Oh my my, oh hell yes, you got to put on that party dress. It was too cold to cry when I woke up alone. I hit my last number, I walked to the road. Last dance with Mary Jane, one more time to kill the pain.
So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Nothing? Why not?
I'm trying to get on the Slice Style Radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's alright. Oh, wait, I might have it.
You might have it.